Today, Saturday, January 5th, 1991, live from the Capitol Rotunda and Pier over statewide South Dakota public television and radio, State House presents Governor George S. Mickelson's second inaugural address. Also, all the statewide elected officials will take their oaths of office. All that's coming up next in a special live edition of State House. Welcome to the Capitol Rotunda, live from Pier, for the second inaugural address and swearing-in of Governor George S. Mickelson. Today, in a ceremony which reminds us of the continuity of democracy in South Dakota, we'll see Governor Mickelson be sworn in for a second four-year term. He'll also give his second inaugural address. Also, all the statewide officers who ran and won in the 1990 election will take their oaths of office as well. And earlier this morning, state legislators took their oath of office. Hello, I'm Todd Davidette, public affairs producer for South Dakota Public Television, along with Al Lundy, who is news producer reporter for South Dakota Public Radio. Governor Mickelson is the 28th governor in 101 years of South Dakota history. The governor's father, George T. Mickelson, also served as governor from 1947 to 1951. The state capitol, dedicated in 1910, saw its first inaugural in 1913 with the inauguration of Governor Frank M. Byrne. The rotunda is packed with guests and dignitaries, legislators, constitutional officers, the governor's staff, family and friends of the governor, and just plain folks. As it has been so many times in the past, the Capitol Rotunda is home to an inaugural ceremony. And joining me today as co-host is Al Lundy of South Dakota Public Radio. Al, this is my first inaugural, but you've seen a few of these.
Seen a few. This is much larger, a lot larger crowd, a lot more places for people to sit. I remember several years ago when Governor Knipe was being re-inaugurated, there were eight of his sons sitting together in one place watching. This crowd's much larger.
Well, it takes a lot of people to put an inaugural on. It's a great festivity. Let's go now to Tom Adam, Master of Ceremonies.
Dakota, and I am delighted to serve you this afternoon as the Master of Ceremonies for this 1991 inaugural program. This program is being broadcast live for the first time by South Dakota Public Television. I understand for those of us who might like to see ourselves on television that it will be rebroadcast later this evening, but at about midnight. Earlier today, our state legislators received their oath of office, and of course, receiving and taking an oath of office is an essential part of this program. But we should remember that the oath of office is not merely a solemn explication of official duties, but it should serve to remind each of us of the very important public service which we performed when we exercised our right to vote. For this important occasion, we have traveled from all regions of the state, and we are gathered here together to observe and celebrate the culmination of this very important democratic process. We also are here to reaffirm as a fact our state motto, that indeed, under God, the people do rule. We hope you enjoy this weekend in your capital city, and a warm, warm welcome to each of you. Donald Vaglin is the pastor of the Asbury United Methodist Church in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. As we invite Reverend Vaglin to the platform, we ask that you remain standing or seated, as we are, quietly and with reverence, as we share the invocation with Reverend Vaglin. Reverend Vaglin.
Let us pray. From the scattered pieces that the fragmented nature of politics has flung about the landscape of our minds, unify each one of us. Lay upon the governor and the legislators such burdens beyond their stature that their stature may increase to match their burdens. Save us from both trying the impossible and also from calling impossible anything which we only have found to be trying. Sometimes we ask for guidance but have found your wisdom uncomfortable when it leads to unpopular decisions. Give our governor and legislators the insight, courage, and compassion to lead the state in this new quadrennium of our second century of statehood. We cannot make the business of state as simple as we wish it were, but keep us from multiplying its complexities unduly. It is our plea that marching sometimes in blindness, we may yet march in the truth, and that serving always in frailty, we may yet add our little strength to the vastness of this state's need. We also ask that although the officially declared year of reconciliation has ended, that the process of reconciliation may continue, and that we may one day truly become one people. Grant us then, attentive minds, the significance of what we do here today may settle upon us. And as we look to the future, may all of us be sobered by the thrust of the message of our state motto, "Under God, the people rule." Amen.
It is a tradition that the Bible is significant in inaugural ceremonies. Today's Bibles have particular significance. The Bible which will be used by the governor is the same Bible that was used by his father, our late governor, George Theodore Mickelson, on his first inaugural on January 7, 1947. The Bible which will be used by Lieutenant Governor Miller is his personal Bible. The Bible which will be used to swear in the other officers is a Dakota Wo-Wapi Wakon, a Bible that has been translated into the Lakota language. These officials were elected in the year of reconciliation, and in the spirit of reconciliation, we are using this Lakota translation of the Bible for this particular ceremony. This particular Bible was actually used by Reverend T.L. Riggs, who preached in the Oahe Chapel when it was located in Fort Sully. It is an 1879 edition and is from our State Historical Society collection. The translation was by the Reverend Stephen Return Riggs, the father of Reverend T.L. Riggs. Robert A. Miller is the Chief Justice of the South Dakota Supreme Court. A native of South Dakota, Justice Miller earned his bachelor's degree and his Juris Doctorate degree from the University of South Dakota. Chief Justice Miller served with distinction the Sixth Judicial Circuit as a circuit court judge from 1971 through 1986. The Chief Justice was then appointed to the Supreme Court and now serves our state as the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court and also of the judiciary. He will administer the oath of office to the governor and lieutenant governor, the other constitutional officers, and the public utilities commissioner. Would you join me, please, in welcoming to the platform Chief Justice Robert A. Miller. Will Governor George S. Mickelson please step forward to receive his oath of office?
I think it's very important that you tell the people of the state of South Dakota what your oath is. Please repeat your oath.
I, George S. Mickelson, do solemnly swear that I will support the Constitution and the laws of the United States and the Constitution and laws of the state of South Dakota, and that I will faithfully discharge the duties of the office of governor of the state of South Dakota.
So help you God.
So help me God.
Congratulations, Governor.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Will Lieutenant Governor Walter Dale Miller please come forward to receive his oath of office?
Lieutenant Governor Miller, like the governor, you have a very awesome oath. Would you please give the people of the state of South Dakota your oath?
I do solemnly swear that I will support the Constitution and the laws of this United States and the Constitution and the laws of the state of South Dakota, and that I will faithfully discharge the duties of my office of Lieutenant Governor.
So help you God.
So help me God.
Congratulations, Lieutenant Governor, and best wishes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Will Attorney General-elect Mark Barnett please come forward to receive his oath of office?
Attorney General Barnett, you also have a very awesome oath to give to the people of the state of South Dakota. Would you please do that?
Yes. I do solemnly swear that I will support the Constitution and the laws of the United States and the Constitution and laws of the state of South Dakota, and that I will faithfully discharge the duties of my office.
So help you God.
So help me God.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Will Secretary of State Joyce Hazeltine please come forward to receive her oath of office?
You do not have to. Okay. Repeat after me. I do solemnly swear.
I do solemnly swear.
That I will support the Constitution and the laws of the United States.
That I will support the Constitution and the laws of the United States.
The Constitution and the laws of the state of South Dakota.
The Constitution and the laws of the state of South Dakota.
And that I will faithfully discharge the duties of my office.
And that I will faithfully discharge the duties of my office.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Congratulations.
Will State Auditor Vernon L. Larson please come forward to receive his oath of office?
Mr. Auditor, you too have a very awesome oath. Would you please give your oath to the people of the state of South Dakota?
I, Vernon L. Larson, do solemnly swear that I will support the Constitution and the laws of the United States and the Constitution and laws of the state of South Dakota, and that I will faithfully discharge the duties of the Office of the State Auditor at the state of South Dakota.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Will State Treasurer-elect G. Homer Harding please come forward to receive his oath of office?
Mr. State Treasurer, you too have an awesome oath to the state of South Dakota, and would you please give the people of the state of South Dakota your oath?
I do solemnly swear that I will support the Constitution and laws of the United States and the Constitution, the laws of the state of South Dakota, and that I will faithfully discharge the duties of my office.
So help you God.
So help me God.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Will Commissioner of School and Public Lands-elect Curtis Johnson please come forward to receive his oath of office?
You too have an awesome oath and an obligation to the people of the state of South Dakota. Would you please give them your oath?
I do solemnly swear that I will support the Constitution and the laws of the United States and the Constitution and the laws of South Dakota, and that I will faithfully discharge the duties of my office.
So help you God.
So help me God.
Congratulations and best wishes.
Will Public Utilities Commissioner Kenneth Stoffren please come forward to receive his oath of office?
Again, you have an awesome responsibility to the public of this state, and please give the people your oath.
I, Ken Stoffren, do solemnly swear that I will support the Constitution and the laws of the United States and the Constitution and the laws of the state of South Dakota, and that I will faithfully discharge the duties of my office.
So help you God.
So help me God.
Best wishes and congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chief Justice. Lisa Albers is a sophomore at New Underwood, South Dakota High School. She is the daughter of Mr. and Mrs. Richard Albers and is also a granddaughter of Lieutenant Governor Walter Miller. Lisa, would you please come forward and share your solo with us?
The song that I would like to share with you today was written for the 1988 Olympics. Its title is One Moment in Time, and it talks about the dreams that people of every age have in striving to achieve their very best. Governor Mickelson and all the other leaders here today have achieved much in their lives, the laws they have passed, and the decisions that they have made to create an even better South Dakota for my generation. As a young person looking ahead, I am grateful for these achievements. And I'm also looking forward to when I and my generation can, in our moment of time, be free to do our best for the generations that come after us.
I'm more.
Thank you, Lisa. That was lovely. Madge Mickelson has been a First Lady of this state since January 7, 1947, the date of the first inaugural of our late Governor George Theodore Mickelson. Join me, please, in recognizing and greeting again First Lady Madge Mickelson. Bright, hardworking, interested, involved, gracious, and more is our First Lady, Linda Mickelson. Join me, please, in recognizing and greeting our First Lady, Linda Mickelson. It is a great personal pleasure for me to be able to present to you the governor of our state, the Honorable George Speaker Mickelson. Governor Mickelson.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Lisa, that was really lovely. If I had a brain in my head, I'd just sit down and wouldn't want to wreck that mood. But nobody, or there are several who have accused me of not having that. I would am really delighted that you are here. Lieutenant Governor Miller, Chief Justice Miller, members of the Supreme Court, Judge Woolman, my fellow constitutional officers, legislators, Debbie Anderson, representing the White House, that we are particularly delighted to have here today, Reverend Vaglin and Nancy, Reverend Tuhawk, Linda, Amy, David, Mom, my sisters and brothers-in-law, and all of our friends, and the great people of South Dakota, especially those who are proudly serving their country in the Middle East today. Thank you. No other words can really express my sincerity, my gratitude, my appreciation for the opportunity that I have been given to serve as governor of this state, the appreciation for the confidence that has been expressed in me by the people of this state. I just flat love this job. The people of South Dakota are my friends and neighbors, and I know all of you who stand for election, as I just did, feel the same way. I vow to you today on this inaugural day that I will do the best job that I can possibly do. But I also ask for your help and the guiding hand of God to show me the right direction and to stay with me through the valleys and over the peaks, just as you have for the last 4 years. I have not done it alone, and I don't intend to walk this path alone for the next 4 years. Teddy Roosevelt, who had a special appreciation, as we do, for the prairies of Dakota and for our Black Hills, whose face is also on Mount Rushmore, knew that each of us must rely to a great extent on common sense to make it through this life. But he also had a very profound understanding that each of us must reach out in caring for our fellow citizens. If we are to do as I believe we shall and will do, he said, if we are to advance in broad humanity and kindliness, the spirit of brotherhood, it must be by developing men who scorn wrongdoing and who at the same time have both the courage and the strength to strive mightily for the right. God has given each of us special talents, and he has also given us a mission to use those talents to his glory, loving one another as we love ourselves. As we set out on the course that we have worked on together for our second century, we must have the courage and the strength to strive mightily for the right, and we must do so with this understanding, that all of the wisdom and the intellect and the common sense that we have been given will mean nothing if we do not use that wisdom and that intellect and common sense to care for and to nurture the individuals who are South Dakota. So I'm not embarrassed to stand before you here today and ask for all of your help. South Dakotans, by their very nature, have always been ready to pitch in when needed and to help. Your involvement and your input are essential as we chart the course for the next century. Our quality of life, our commitment to quality education, our clean environment, our productive workforce, and our staunch family values provide a strong foundation on which to create and to mold and to shape a future, as I told you from this riser in my first inaugural address 4 years ago. Most of us really very little realize on a day-to-day basis the influence that our parents have on us. Certainly, we can appreciate and experience the love that they share every day. And certainly as we get older, perhaps as we get much older, we can appreciate the sacrifices they make for us. But there are other subtle influences often that we don't discover, or that we discover later in life, often by accident. I cannot help but sit here today, not with any small amount of nostalgia, and think about the influence that my mother has had. Certainly, there's probably no one in this great rotunda here today that has attended more inaugurals by choice or by chance than my mother. But I recently made a discovery about those kinds of influences myself. As Tom Adam indicated, my own father, as you probably know, served as the governor of this state in the late 1940s. I was just a child at the time, but I remember the demands of the job often took him away for long periods of time. And as I have gotten to think about that over the last 4 years, I've begun to appreciate more and more what he was all about. Transportation in those days didn't afford him the opportunity to be home at night when he set out during the day. I knew it was a sacrifice that the family made because it was just part of his job. But I just knew that my dad was gone a lot. But what I really didn't understand until recently is that my dad made those trips because he so strongly loved the people of this state and believed so strongly in this state. He believed that he must meet with the people in their hometowns and in their places of business, that he must seize this opportunity for free exchange of information with them and learn firsthand their needs. He did it for days and weeks at a time because he cared about their concerns. It is my hope that this next 4 years, as we have for the last, may be remembered at least in some degree about that same kind of effort, and I know my fellow constitutional officers feel the same way. I've met with thousands of you across the state of South Dakota on our Capital for a Day program. One of the great and certainly best-loved governors, Sig Anderson, who just died before Christmas, joined me on one such a Capital for a Day program when my staff and cabinet and I visited Webster, and I always enjoyed his valuable input. I listened to your equally valuable concerns as I visited your communities to hold forums on education and rural health. I visited with you in the cafes over a cup of coffee at grassroots meetings designed so that I could listen. And as I campaigned for re-election to this office, Lieutenant Governor Miller and my wife Linda and I reached virtually every corner of this great state as you welcomed us, and I'm glad to say you were not hesitant to let us know what you thought on a variety of issues. Well, we heard your concerns. From all of those meetings, we developed a consensus on issues ranging from economic development to education, from rural health to protecting our environment. We created a vision together, you and I, so that we can plan and work for our future. We created tools to achieve that vision. And now that we have the tools, now that we have the blueprints to proceed, now we have to put those tools to use. And we will take those plans that we have created together and we'll implement them. And we have that vision firmly in our grasp. We can, and we must, and we will modernize education in South Dakota, building on a system which makes our students among the best in the country today, and preparing those in school now so that they will not only be able to compete internationally in a fast-changing world, but also be able to use the skills they develop in school as they prepare to apply what they have learned to the workplace, regardless of where that workplace may be. We won't wait either for the changes in education to take place around the country. In fact, others will follow our lead because this state is going to implement those changes now. We will diversify our economy, providing job opportunities for the vast array of skills and professions, expanding and attracting new industry that creates more industry. We will develop agricultural processing in the state of South Dakota to provide better and more lucrative market for our farm products, allowing and encouraging young people who choose to stay in farming or get into farming have that opportunity. We will link industry and education as we continue to provide one of the most productive workforces in the United States today. And we will provide an effective transportation system to not only ensure the tradition of the farm-to-market roads, as we have known have been so important to our state, but also to create and build on our highway systems, railroads, and air service in order to pursue economic diversity for which our plans are laid. As our rural population increasingly ages, we will make certain that our citizens do not only have quality health care, but access to it. We will care for our senior citizens, those people who have given so much to make this great state what it is today, by helping them stay as independent as they can for as long as they can, helping them continue not only with a quality lifestyle, but one which dignifies their long contributions to the community. We will protect our environment, taking tools which we have developed in the last 4 years, tools which in all reality have set an example in no small measure for the rest of the country. And we will strengthen them, ensuring that we continue to breathe the cleanest air and drink the purest water and till the fertile soil of South Dakota prairie through the next 100 years. And we will, ladies and gentlemen, continue to fight to perfect our rights in the Missouri River, a dream shared by my father as he stood on the hillside north of Pierre here as they took that first shovelful out for the Great Owyhee Dam. We will do this together. We will continue to build through consensus, but most importantly, we will do so with God's help. The Great Spirit made us both, Chief Standing Bear said in 1879, and that, I believe, should continue to be a theme for the years to come as we prepare to depart on our journey for the next 4 years. As you and I look back 100 years, think about this, if you will. As you and I look back on what we know, as we look back 100 years, we see white South Dakotans who, for the most part, knew very little about the Indian Wars, which had ensued on the prairie for a number of years. They learned about the massacre at Wounded Knee through delayed newspaper reports. They were busy setting a vision as they saw it at that time for a new state. They were more concerned about recovering from a drought, about setting up a system of roads, about merely surviving winter blizzards. But ladies and gentlemen, if there is one thing I would hope that you and I can agree on today, is that as our children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren look back 100 years from today, as they judge us, I want them to see that you and I, we're not only concerned about education, about economic development, about health care, about the environment. I want them to see that you and I, Indian and non-Indian, were concerned about one another. I want them to know that we took our first step towards reconciliation together. 100 years from now, as Native Americans stand side by side, hand in hand, with what I expect to be an even greater diversity of cultures than we presently celebrate in this state, I want them to know you and I set that stage. For the past 4 years, we charted a course for our future. We knew our successes would someday be measured by men and women. Certainly, that kind of measurement is valuable. But now, as we actually set out to implement our plans, we must remember that the Almighty will ultimately measure what we do by what we did for one another. We will pursue quality education so that our students will be given every opportunity to excel, but more importantly, so that all young people in this state, regardless of wealth or status, will be able to discover the talents which God has given them and then put those talents to use for the good of the whole. We will pursue economic development, building on our excellent business climate, but more importantly, reaching for those businesses and those jobs which provide opportunities for their employees to advance, to excel, and to find satisfaction at what they do while earning wage or salary that enables them and their families to enjoy a quality life. We will care for the elderly, and we will protect our environment. Both are God-given treasures, and if we are to show our love for God, we must show our love for our parents and our earth. As I stood before you 4 years ago to thank you for entrusting me with this office, this Capitol rotunda was gleaming in red, white, and blue bunting, much as it is here today. But since that time, there have been historic changes. We've celebrated our state centennial here. We have shared the pipe ceremony with our Native American friends here. We've been joined by four sculptures in the four corners of this rotunda, representing wisdom, vision, courage, and integrity. The plans that you and I have made together over the last 4 years have hopefully been inspired by wisdom and vision. As we depart on the next 4 years, it is my fervent hope that we will do so with courage and integrity. I don't profess to be a scholar of the Bible, unfortunately, but I do remember hearing Don Vagland and others that have meant a great deal to me over the years give messages that have been inspired by what I understand to be Paul's treatise on faith, hope, and love. As he said to the Corinthians, I may have the gift of inspired preaching. I may have all knowledge and understand all secrets. I may have all the faith needed to move mountains, but if I have no love, I am nothing. We're ready to depart on our journey. We will do so with a plan which we have developed in faith and in hope. But it will be the love we have for one another, for the people of this state, which will ultimately be our yardstick for success. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Governor Mickelson. Deborah Anderson is a South Dakotan. While residing in our state, she served us as a member of the House of Representatives As a member of the House, she served in various leadership positions, including the position of Speaker of the House. Deborah is currently a Deputy Assistant to President Bush. Join me, please, in welcoming back Deborah Anderson.
Thank you, Tom. It's great to be back in South Dakota. It truly is. I just love coming back here and having an opportunity to see so many good friends. And I want to offer my personal congratulations to the governor, the lieutenant governor, and the constitutional officers. And I don't want to be remiss. I want to also offer my congratulations to all of the members of the House and the Senate that were sworn in today. And I truly have a twinge of regret that I won't be going into session with you next Tuesday, but you know I'll be thinking of all of you. I do bring a message today for the governor that I would like to read. It's dated January 5th, 1991. I am delighted to extend my warmest greetings to all those gathered for the inauguration of my friend George Mickelson as governor of South Dakota. George Mickelson has served the state of South Dakota with distinction, and the people of South Dakota have wisely invested their confidence in him for a second term. Inaugurals are a time for renewal and rededication. South Dakota has a bright future, and I share the high hopes that are so much a part of this day. I value the relationship I have with the nation's governors. They provide leadership in a challenging arena, and every day their work impacts the lives of the people they represent. George Mickelson brings to this office a special understanding of the concerns of the citizens of South Dakota and valuable insights into the opportunities facing your great state. Barbara joins me in sending you our very best wishes on this special day. Signed, George Bush.
Thank you, Deborah. We are now at about the conclusion of this inaugural program. I would simply remind you of the following events. At about 5:30 this evening, on the first floor in the Capitol building, there will be a receiving line for the inaugural party. At about 8 o'clock p.m. this evening, here on the second floor, the Capitol ball will commence. And at about 8:30 here on the second floor, there will be a grand march. At about 9 o'clock, there will be a celebration dance at the King's Inn Convention Center, and at that time, also another inaugural ball at the River Center. And as I understand it, at about 10:30 this evening, another grand march at the River Center. Webster Tuhawk is the priest at the St. Peter's Episcopal Church in Fort Pierce, South Dakota. We invite Pastor Tuhawk to the platform for the benediction, suggesting again that we sit or stand as we are, quietly and with reverence. Reverend Tuhawk.
Cheonkiapikta, let us pray. Lord God, our governor, bless the leaders of our land, that we may be a people at peace among ourselves and a blessing to other nations of the earth. To the President and members of the Cabinet, to governors of this and especially South Dakota, and to all in administrative authority, grant wisdom and grace in the exercise of their duties. To senators and representatives and those who make our laws in this state, give courage, wisdom, and foresight to provide for the needs of all our people, to fulfill our obligations in the community of our nations. Finally, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, send down upon Governor George Mickelson, upon the Lieutenant Governor, upon their staff, those who hold office in this state, the spirit of wisdom, charity, and justice, that with steadfast purpose they may faithfully serve in their offices to promote the well-beings of all people. Now, ate apiki na chihitku ki na wonia wa kanki, ampetu ki leel ni chipi unuwe. Amen. O hechitu.
Thank you very much, and with the permission of the Governor and First Lady, I will adjourn this 1991 Centennial Program. Thank you very much.
You've just seen and heard the inauguration of Governor George Mickelson and the oaths of office administered to the constitutional officers of the state of South Dakota. We also heard from Deborah Anderson from President Bush's staff, Deb Anderson, the former Speaker of the House here in South Dakota. Just heard Reverend Tuhawk and Reverend Beglin. Only in South Dakota, when you have an inauguration, could it be this egalitarian. People in suits, people in sweatsuits, people in cowboy boots and wingtips. Old and young here in the Capitol building celebrating democracy. Governor Mickelson is the only son of a governor to himself become governor. As I think we've reminded you throughout this broadcast, Governor Mickelson's father, George T. Mickelson, served as governor in the late 40s and early 50s. During the governor's address, he had themes of unity, humility, and love, reaching out to South Dakotans all across the state, and reaching out to Indians and non-Indians, and also recapping much of his first term and many of the themes that he touched on in his rather brief address, economic development, which was one of his biggest issues in early on in his administration. He has continued to push for economic development in the state. Environmental quality, education, he has just announced some new educational initiatives that we'll be hearing more about during the upcoming session. Reconciliation was a major theme in today's address. We've just come off the year of reconciliation, which was proclaimed by the governor in 1990, and we've had many ceremonies and activities concerning that through the year, and those efforts, as the governor said, will be continuing during his term. We heard references to the second century. Governor Mickelson presided over the centennial in the state of South Dakota in 1989, a big celebration I'm sure many of you enjoyed and caught here on South Dakota Public Television. Also, he mentioned his he will continue working for better transportation across South Dakota and his commitment to helping the elderly in South Dakota. One of the other things that he mentioned that was interesting was he talked about what we learned from our parents, only we don't really know that we've learned it from them at the time. And he talked about his father and his father going out across the state and getting what the people have to say, and the governor mentioning his Capital for a Day program. Al Lundy from South Dakota Public Radio is standing by with a special guest, and Al, take it away.
Thank you, Todd. With me is Shelley Stingley. She's special assistant to Governor George Mickelson. She's not the organizer of all this, but she's the one that has made sure everything's happened right and even helped us out quite a bit. Good morning.
Good morning. How are you?
I guess it's afternoon by now.
It's now it's afternoon.
How big a job is this, really, to make sure everything happens?
Well, it starts really the day after the election, when you know that you are truly going to be inaugurated into the office. Then you have to start with the plans and make the decisions on who's going to be on the program and get the letters out of invitation and work with the city of Pierre to see that the inaugural comes off.
The city of Pierre really organizes most of the activity, doesn't it, outside the Capitol at least?
Outside the Capitol building for the actual inaugural ceremony, the city of Pierre and the mayor is the host of this inauguration.
So this year it's different, much larger really, three different events I think outside the Capitol.
That's correct. They're following the centennial celebration format and having that there are three balls, giving them people a chance to see the Capitol building and dance in the rotunda of the Capitol building again.
Well, that was certainly exciting at the time and quite an event. What about the other two? There is one at River Center and another one.
There's one at the King's Inn, which is a more casual type dance. We invite people to come and enjoy just a casual time. The one at the Ramcota will be a more formal event, and it gives people a more opportunity to dance, and it can hold a lot more people than was ever possible at the Riggs Theater or in the Capitol Rotunda.
Well, if I can say this, you helped us a little bit earlier. We're not going to talk about exactly what happened, but you've helped us quite a bit in our setup for public television and radio here. What are some of the things that you've had to do otherwise to make sure that everything goes just the way it's planned, it's the event that everyone wants?
Well, of course, you have to make sure you have enough chairs for the people that think they need chairs, and there's never enough room in this building. It's a big building, but it's not enough room. There's legislators to see that they have chairs. There's podiums to see that they're ready. Make sure that all the constitutional officers understand how the program's going to run, and just see that it moves on time and gets over when it's supposed to.
There are a lot of law enforcement types around this morning, or this afternoon as well. How many law enforcement are involved?
I really don't have any idea. They're here for the safety of the public. We always want to be sure that if someone has a medical emergency, we have ambulances standing by. It is with this many people in this building, you've got to make sure that everybody's safe.
How many are really here in the building? I didn't count the chairs.
I think I had chairs for about 350 people, and there were people on the steps, in the hallways, up above. So I would guess 500 to 600 people.
Now, were you involved at all with the one 4 years ago, the event 4 years ago?
I was involved a little bit 4 years ago. 8 years ago, I had the same role as I did at this one.
But what happens then as far as, is there a committee that you work with then? Or do you work with the mayor of Pierre directly? How does that work?
The city of Pierre sets up a committee, and Wally Thompson is the chairman of that committee this year. And I am the liaison from the governor's office to that committee, and we work starting, they start work before the election is over because they know they're going to have an inaugural one way or the other. They just don't know who they're going to work with. And then after the election, the liaison from the office goes down and starts working with the committee for the final plans of the inaugural.
Okay, well, we would like to thank you, and I think the people of South Dakota, if I can say that, would like to thank you too. It's been an event for us that we've enjoyed, and you helped us, as we said, and thank you very much for being with us, Shelley.
Thank you.
Todd?
Thanks, Al. And again, my thanks to Shelley Stingley and the governor's staff, and my thanks to everyone in South Dakota Public Broadcasting crew here in Pierre and across South Dakota and Brookings Vermilion, and particularly our engineers who helped get our signal across the state. Thanks a lot. Everyone did a great job. Our live coverage of the inaugural today continues our extensive coverage of the South Dakota Legislature on South Dakota Public Radio and Television. Watch South Dakota Public Television Tuesday night at 9 Central, 8 Mountain for same-day coverage of Governor Mickelson's fifth State of the State Address and the Democrats' legislative agenda. South Dakota Public Radio will carry the State of the State Address live Tuesday at noon Central, 11 a.m. Mountain Time. Then Wednesday night at 10:30, South Dakota Public Television State House program begins with same and next day coverage of the South Dakota Legislature. And for the most up-to-the-minute reports about the session, tune in to South Dakota Public Radio during Morning Edition, the Midday Report, and All Things Considered. So, until Tuesday, bringing you the people's business from the Capitol and Pier, for Al Lundy and South Dakota Public Broadcasting, I'm Todd Epp. Thanks for watching. So long.